Hi everybody and welcome to my channel. Thank you so much for clicking on this video. If you're new here, my name is Leah and most of my videos are focused on unsolved crimes and mysteries. If you're a returning subscriber, welcome back and thank you so much for supporting me. It means a lot to me. So as you can see, the background of my video is very different today. It's because I'm on holiday in Denmark and I'm currently living in my sister's house. And she gave me very special permission to record in her house. So I'm actually sitting in her couch. So that's nice. We started talking about cases and she reminded me of a young girl that was murdered here in 2016. I will never forget that case. So I decided to go visit the area where she was kidnapped from. And I also went to the area where she was found on Christmas Day. And I went on YouTube to see if someone did her story. And I was actually really happy to see that someone did. I don't want her to be forgotten. But I also saw there was no update on her case. And there is an update, a major, huge one. I couldn't believe that nobody updated the case. So that's what I'm gonna do today, because for 7 years the killer wasn't found, but now they have someone in custody because he messed up big time. When you hear about the amazing work the police did, you're gonna be like, so just stay with me and let's do this. Emilie Meng was a beautiful 17-year-old girl living in Korsør in Denmark with her mom, Helen Meng. She was loved and adored by family and friends and was known to be loving, caring, funny, and just a really great person. She was on her second year in college and was always very focused on her grades and all the school projects that she was involved in. She had a really bright future ahead of her. She was also singing in the church choir and loved spending time with her friends. They would hang out in each other's houses, go out to cafes, and just do what 17-year-old girls do. Emilie had just broken up with her boyfriend and was feeling a bit down. So on Saturday, the 9th of July 2016, Emilie and three of her friends decided to go out. They went to Korsør train station and took the train to Slagelse, which is a 9-minute train ride from Korsør. They went to a water pipe cafe where they sat at their table. They had a few drinks, they were laughing and talking and just having a really great girls' night out. By the end of the night, they decided to go get something to eat in McDonald's and then head back to Slagelse train station. When the train arrived back in Korsør, it was about 4 a.m. The three friends jumped in one of the taxis outside and told Emilie to get in. But Emilie was still feeling a bit down because of her broken heart and she insisted on walking home. She just needed some alone time to sort out her thoughts. But instead of walking on the main road, she went down a path that starts close to the train station and continues about 3-4 kilometers into Korsør Centrum. The path cuts through a lot of fields with trees on both sides, and not long after she started walking, her mobile ran out of charge or was closed on purpose. Nobody knows for sure. Emilie's mom woke up in the morning and realized that Emilie, she is not in her room. She thought she might have been sleeping in a friend's house, but when Emilie doesn't show up for choir practice in the church, her mom gets really worried and calls Emilie's friends. They all explained to her that they took a taxi home from the train station, but Emilie, she insisted on walking home. Her mom knew straight away that something was very wrong and called the police. The police came out to question her mom and the three friends, and they told them about their night out and that Emilie was a bit sad because of the breakup. And the police asked if Emilie had ran away before, and her mom tells them that she did run away once before and stayed in Copenhagen for a few days. The police made the big mistake assuming that she had run away again. And for 4 days, they were not searching for Emilie And even though they asked in public for Emilie to come forward, she never did. After 4 days, the police realized that this was really serious. They called in special forces to help them with the case. They checked the mobile data on Emilie's mobile phone, but nothing really stood out. When they checked the security cameras inside the train station and they saw Emilie on the video heading for the exit of the train station, they also saw a very blurry image or video of a white car leaving the area right after Emilie left. The police made the video and an image public and told the driver of the white car to come forward because they could have been a witness to something that they didn't even know. But nobody came forward. So they sent the video to some experts so they could try to sharpen the video and maybe find out what kind of model the white car was. It took them almost 1 year to fix the video, and they said that they believe it was a white Hyundai i30. They made that public as well, but still no one came forward. Volunteers started several Facebook groups and everybody wanted to find Emilie. More than 500 volunteers signed up and they were set up in teams. They started searching everywhere from the train station and all the way to the end of the path. They searched the fields, the woods and several marsh areas, but no luck. But they didn't give up. They went out searching as often as they could. Missing person flyers were hung up on every street corner, in bus stops, every train station. Her face was shared all over the news and everywhere on social media, but still no luck. Still no news about Emilie Meng. Some of the volunteers took matters into their own hands. There were a few volunteers that was convinced that one of their neighbors was holding Emilie captive in his house. They were 100% sure they could hear a girl cry for help and begging that guy to let her go. So they set up illegal microphones and recorded everything going on in the neighbor's home. There were several people that thought they heard Emilie, so they reported it to the police. And the result was that the police searched his house 5 times. They were doing drillings inside his house and even started digging in his garden. But they didn't find anything. An expert listened to their recordings and then they didn't hear anything. They didn't hear any crying or anyone asking for help. They actually didn't hear any voice at all. So the witch hunt on this neighbor had to stop. The volunteers felt really bad and went to his house with flowers, chocolate, and an apology. People were getting really frustrated because there were no other clues than that white Hyundai, and it felt like Emilie, she just vanished. 5 months went by and still no news about Emilie Meng. In the morning hours on the 24th of December 2016, 65 kilometers from Korsør, a man was out walking his dog in a mask and he spotted something in the water and decided to take a closer look. And that's when he realized that there was a deceased body in the water. He called the police and they came out to the mask to investigate and take the body out of the water and bring it to the coroner's office. DNA tests and examination were performed, and the following day the police held a press conference. They told the public that a body had been found and they could confirm that the body found was Emilie Meng, and they could also confirm that she was a victim of a crime. About 600 people were interviewed by the police. DNA was collected from about 1,200 people. The police checked all tips that were called in. They worked really hard, but still no new clues about Emilie Meng, except for the white Hyundai. 7 years went by and everything had started slowing down, and it actually went really quiet. We didn't really get any updates anymore. The tip line also got more and more quiet. It was really sad. Then the 15th of April 2023, the police was back on TV with a new press conference. A 13-year-old girl was up early in the morning doing her paper route. She was on her push bike going from house to house in the country area delivering newspapers. She was finished about 11:30 a.m. and she called her stepdad to let him know she was on her way home. It was only a 5-kilometer trip on her push bike, but she didn't come home. Her stepdad became very worried and called the police, and the police came out and went out to look for her on her paper route. Their hearts dropped when they found her push bike and her mobile phone on the side of the road. This poor girl has been through hell and don't want her name or her picture out there anymore. So I want to respect that, so I'm just going to call her Jennifer. Her picture and her name was shared everywhere, and the police told the public to check business security cameras, private security cameras, and dash cams. They got about 350 tips and received so many video material. 27 hours later, another press conference was planned to be held at 3 p.m. All Danish people were glued to the TV hoping and praying that Jennifer was okay and alive. We were then told that the press conference was delayed for 10-15 minutes because there had been a development in the case. I remember we were all holding our breath. The chief of police came on and said, "We want to let the public know that we found Jennifer," and then he took a pause that seemed like forever. He then said, "She's alive and conscious." Oh my God, what a relief. The police had surrounded his house, and when they broke down the door, they found Jennifer inside with the 32-year-old man. They arrested him and brought him to the police station. And the police just had this gut feeling that this wasn't the first time he had done something like this. They got a search warrant to search his house, and they were seen taking several items with them, but what they took is unknown to the public. They also decided to start looking into old cases. In 2016, Emilie Meng was kidnapped, raped, and murdered. We don't know if the police got DNA from her body. In 2022, a young girl from a boarding school was attempted kidnapped in November, but she was screaming and fought him off, but the 32-year-old man, his DNA was found on her jacket. And now Jennifer, a 13-year-old girl, was kidnapped and raped as well. He's now in prison facing several charges. 2 counts of kidnapping, 2 counts of rape, 1 count of attempted kidnapping, and 1 count of murder. The police started investigating the 32-year-old man, and you're not gonna believe this. They found out that he actually owned a white Hyundai in 2016. After Emilie was kidnapped and murdered and the police was searching for that car, he completely broke his car and crashed it on purpose and sold it to a scrap dealer. So he thought the car was history and believed the car would be destroyed. But no, it didn't work out that way. The scrap dealer decided he could repair the car and make more money selling it. And not only did he sold it to Slovakia. The police tracked down the car and they contacted the Slovakian police and told them to find the car, pick it up and bring it back to Denmark, and they did. Can you believe they actually found the car? They said there are some things that's almost impossible to clean out of a car. I would imagine it would be something like saliva, blood, semen, urine, and so on. Because if it goes deep into the car seats, it would be very hard to get it all out when you're cleaning your seats. So the police received the car from Slovakia, and they're working very, very hard on that car now. I would imagine they have torn it into a million pieces to check every single detail. They also checked his mobile data, and his mobile pinged close to Korsør train station when Emilie went missing. We all believe he is definitely the one in all three cases, but now the police just have to prove it. And actually, it had just come out last week that they found two more cases of young girls that has been attempted kidnapped, but they're investigating that as well. So now we are all just waiting for the results. Did they find DNA in the car? Did they find any souvenirs in his house from his victims? Was he working alone or did he have a partner? Is there more cases connected to him? I am definitely gonna keep you updated on this case. This case is so crazy, and I cannot believe this guy hasn't been caught earlier. To me, it's pretty obvious that when Emilia, she leaves the train station, she's walking direct to that path. He's parked on the parking lot in front of the train station. He lives in the same city, so he know this path very well. And he knew where she was gonna come out when she reached the end. They have built different paths and factories there now, but in 2016 there was no other path and there was no factories. It was just one big area full of fields, and there was just the path that Emilia was walking on, and on the path there were trees on both sides. So she was walking on that path, he took his car and drove around it. So there you can see on the pictures, it's actually really, really creepy. They're walking and driving parallel to each other. But he's in the car, so of course he's faster than her. So he reached the point outside the retirement home before her, and he's just sitting there waiting for her. I think it's so creepy and disgusting. And there was an elderly man who heard a very heartbreaking, very loud scream that morning, but the police didn't take him seriously. Maybe they should have. Because Emilia was seen on camera number one, but she never made it to camera number two in the end of the same building. So to me, it looks like he was either waiting for her here or he was waiting for her here. Because in Denmark, it's illegal for any shop, any business, any house owner to record a public road. You can't do that. You can do it on your own property, but you can't record and have surveillance on a public road. So the only way he would be out of view of the camera is if he was parked either on the right side or this side, which is the left side. And he grabbed her and forced her in the car. And that's the last time anyone ever saw her.
You never really
that's it for today's video. I want to thank you all so much for watching. I promise I'm going to keep you updated because we all need some answers, and especially the families and the victims, so they can get some closure and hopefully be able to move on with their lives. So until the next one, take care and stay safe. Bye.